he wanted to come, guys, but he's got a wedding this weekend, so he sends you all his love. But he really wanted to be here, too.
How's it going? Welcome.
Oh, thank you.
It's good to see you.
Hey, how you doing?
Doing well.
Hey, Holly.
How great is it that we got stuck in an elevator this morning?
What's that like?
Up and down, up and down, up and down. And it was like a trailer for the trailer.
Yeah.
So, Ethan, I was going to ask you, it's very good to see you. You know, one of the things, if I could, real quick, is that, I mean, with the heritage of your family, this must be so satisfying for you to have this amazing moment in your career. As I'm sure you have those grandfathers, Gregory Peck, you know, Atticus Finch, one of the greatest hero in history of film by the American Film Institute. What's that like for you? I mean, that must be a nice...
Man, it's just like layer upon layer of surreality. It's no one's saying. Just like rarefied life experience. I like living with you.
It's fantastic. And Rebecca, how are you?
I'm doing great, thank you. Very, very happy to be here. Thrilled to be a part of this universe, to be a part of the Star Trek family. It's just, it's pinch-me moment after pinch-me moment. I mean, walking onto the Enterprise set for the first time.
The Enterprise set.
Oh my God. Really.
And, you know, there's nothing quite like Star Trek. I mean, it really is a special thing.
It really is.
Yeah. Fantastic. Well, anything else you guys want to tell us about season 3? I mean, I know there are snipers if we say too much.
You're going to love David.
Yes. So David plays a book. His full name is Cleveland Booker. He will be a character who isn't exactly what you expect right away. When they get to the other side of the wormhole, they have big problems. In fact, even getting to find each other may be really difficult, because they may not have actually landed in the same place.
They are on
an Iceland, yes.
Right. I feel like also just in terms of discovery, there's just so much more of that. We go to the deepest level of discovery in season 3 because we're in this new place together. And we have to figure out everything about where we are and who we are now, you know? And so I really love that from a character perspective that everybody is really unfolding in these really sort of impelling and compelling ways. It's exciting.
And it's true, it really applies to all the characters in Discovery. I think what Burnham carries with her, which is fascinating, is this kind of tremendous sense of responsibility to care of everybody. And obviously, that extends to the idea that she, you know, she felt that she had to leave her ship in time to save all sorts of life. That's a really big burden to bear. That's a lot. And, you know, to explore for her character what that means and, you know, at what point is it too much? At what point is it too much to carry? So she goes through a lot of changes, as do all the characters in many different ways. And obviously, we left unresolved at the end of last season who the captain of Discovery was going to be. And the captain will be something you'll find out about when you watch the
show. You know, as someone watching it from the outside, it seems like the show it just really hit a rhythm in season 2. And the finale, and all the things that were going on at the end of it, there was a lot of excitement as a viewer. And I'm just wondering if you guys feel the same, like, as far as like the energy, do you feel like you really kicked the extra gear?
1,000%. You know, very grateful for everybody that has been a part of the company from the very beginning. And I said it before, we hit the ground running, and I feel like we took flight. You know, and it really feels that way for all of us. There's this sense of brewing, you know, sort of like fire and passion and heart, you know, and really excited about the next, you know, the next stage and the next path that we're forging. And that goes for everything. It goes for the entire universe that is expanding, you know? It's like everybody's buzzing.
Yeah.
I think what's been great too is in the second season more than the first, we were able to lean into, I think, the tone of what a lot of people expect out of Star Trek, which is having a lot more fun and adventure with the drama. And I think obviously this season is inherent to being dramatic because our whole crew left their entire family behind and basically chose the family that they are now with. Cool. And so there's inherent drama in that, but there's also there is going to be fun and humor, and you're still going to have the characters love. And the only reason they are here is because shooting in Toronto, but I think it's when you're saying that you're sorry, I think it had a lot to do with
Yeah, and look, we can't understand how critical to the overall tone of Captain Pike number one and Spock were last season. Mm-hmm. They were everything, and all things being equal, we would have brought them with us, but that would have broken canon in ways that you would have thrown tomatoes at us and that
would have been tomatoes.
But it would have been tomatoes. So we were very excited about doing the short effects, and there's obviously been a lot of speculation about whether Pike and number one and Spock would get their own show. So I guess my question to you guys is, do you want them to get their own show? Okay, we'll think about it.
I think speaking of the cinematic quality that you were talking about, and us taking this to the next level, because we always are, there's also this magic, too, that we keep taking to the next level. And, you know, this man is magic. This woman is magic. This man is magic as well. And so is everyone else. And this man. And this woman. And this woman. And everybody else. So I think that, you know, in addition to just the cinematic part, you know, that's being aesthetically brilliant, there's also this magic. And like we never were before in season two, and then expanding like we are, and then going to a future that we've never seen before in season three.
And the family element, I mean, really, if you look at Gene Roddenberry's vision, I mean, the thing that made Star Trek so unique isn't necessarily the plants they went through, or the aliens they met, or the threats they dealt with, it was the unified family that grew, and the dynamic of it, and the fact that that's such an emphasis for you, that bodes very well for the series.
It is, and it's, you know, the great thing about the third season of television shows that, you know, season one was about these people kind of coming together and figuring out who they were together. Season two was about really solidifying them. But then, as you said, they choose each other for eternity, and they leave their birth families behind. And Star Trek has always been a show about a bridge to family. And I love that this season we get to start mixing and match relationships between different characters, people who you've met, but actually only gotten to know personally, or met, take center stage in a different kind of way. Ton of new characters. There's going to be a whole exploration of what the world looks like 1,000 years from now. From a, you know, when you ask about the cinema of it, boy, we have our work cut out for us in terms of, you know, the design teams have been busy at work, because we're building a future that is complicated. And the thing that I think defines Trek is that it always pays attention to the small character moments in the middle of all the big. Always about the little, it's always about the humans and the human interaction and the interspecial interaction, and that has to be the focus of the show. So what we didn't want was, you know, now there's a lot of eye candy with big floating cities all over the place and all the cliches that you've seen a million times. So yes, we'll have a lot of eye candy, but our focus is always on what does it mean and what does it do for the characters. And, you know, hopefully that's why you feel good about the way that looks and that feels, and yes, there's a tremendous army of artists who are working, you know, daily and tirelessly to make it look like a movie, which is really what we're trying to do every week.
And just that.
Okay, go for it.
Awesome.
Just about going to the future, you were talking earlier about how it's a little bit tricky, or it might be a little bit tricky in the future, and the original Star Trek did so beautifully, was focused on the family, and I think the family of this crew of Starfleet of the Federation is the CZ gives us the opportunity to hone in on that even more in a way that we're all super excited about.
Is there a Horta? Is that really
a Horta? What's with you and the Horta?
I love the Horta.
You love it, and you're always asking the Horta.
I love to play the Horta.
Okay. I'm scared we're casting stuff right now.
I know, yeah.
I have everything it takes. Nothing. Well, I can't believe it's time. But
is it? What, really?
Yes, we have to let the next Star Trek.